Now to another of our occasional series, New Lives. For most of her adult life, 40-year-old Sue Durant was part of a Christian fundamentalist cult. It was one of the Revival Centre International's grouping. But after 18 years, she left the group and, as she said, she began life again. It wasn't an easy move. It was filled with guilt and fear. And it was complicated by the continuing involvement in the group of her two children and husband. Sue Durant joins me now. Welcome.
Hi, Geraldine. Thank you.
Look, I wonder, Sue, what's your most striking or enduring insight of life inside the cult?
Oh, inside the cult, it was very controlling. It was a very limiting sort of lifestyle. When I first joined at 17, in a situation where I'd moved from the country to the city, it gave me a chance to feel part of something. But it wasn't long, as sort of time went along, I grew a bit sort of suspicious that they didn't really seem Christian, that they were in fact very controlling.
And didn't allow you a capacity to grow, in a sense?
Oh, no, definitely not.
And what about, was it a simple life, though? A lot of people yearn for simplicity. Was that there?
It was certainly a very black and white life. You know, in hindsight, you didn't really have to think too much. Everything was sort of told to you. It was a lifestyle that seemed very family orientated. They had their own camps, they had youth groups, they had, you know, activities galore. And from that sort of point of view, you had sort of, it would appear, your spiritual and your social life all wrapped up in one.
So you didn't have time to brood, by the sound of it.
Oh, no.
Oh, I see.
It was very active.
Idle hands and all that. Therefore, did that go hand in hand with a somewhat traditional arrangement in terms of family life, like, you know, men and women and role
yes.
of children?
Well, a traditional role in a very archaic sense, as far as the man was the head of the house, the woman was a second-rate citizen, the children, you know, were seen and not heard. You know, it was very... The children were disciplined very strictly.
Were they?
Yeah.
For instance?
Oh, they believed that if you spared the rod, you spoiled the child.
I see. And when you say women were second-class citizens, give me another example of what you mean.
Well, one example, I suppose, within the church itself was that women were not allowed to hold any particular office. They weren't allowed to, you know, hand out communion or, you know, be a representative as a house leader, perhaps.
And if you did feel like disagreeing, were there avenues to do that?
Not really. They say that there are. For myself, I actually tried to leave over a period of 7 years. It took me that long to escape, if you like, because it was you were taught that the world was evil and wrong. So, but in that 7 years, I actually grew in my strength to approach people, the oversight, the pastors, and talk with various ones and discuss my difficulties. But I was more or less sort of just put back on the right track and told to sit down and be quiet.
Right. Okay. So you weren't regarded as important enough to seriously worry about that you were in crisis or that you could cause trouble.
I think a few individuals tried. You know, to steer me in the right way. Mm. But I think generally, no, I was not considered important enough.
So why did you decide to leave then?
Well, I think as my children got older, you know, that I began to see that if I didn't do something, they were just going to be channeled into this way of thinking. I was fortunate I'd had an Anglican upbringing, so I had a comparison, whereas a lot of people who grow up in the organisation don't have anything to compare with.
How old were you, by the way, when you got into it?
I was 17 when I joined through a friend at school. Yeah,
and so met your husband in there?
I was married by the time the day after I turned 20.
Uh-huh.
So it was very, they do that intentionally. They're very quick to introduce couples and marry them quickly. And in hindsight, the idea is to keep people in the cult, you know, through this arrangement. But as the children got older, I really began to sort of question that I didn't want them to necessarily follow this path. I wanted them to have other options.
How did you leave, Sue?
I was told in the end that if I left, my children would be taken away from me. And one day I threw a change of underpants into the school bags as the children and I went off to school. And I got a friend to drive me to legal aid and I went to a woman's refuge. So it was sort of an overnight sort of thing. Like one minute I was there and the next I wasn't, after thinking it through for, like I say, 7 years.
You escaped. I mean, it's...
It sounds awful, doesn't it?
Jumping the Berlin Wall, isn't it? The important thing is you left without the children.
No,
oh,
I took the children with me.
You. Oh,
At the Women's Refuge, I spent 8 weeks and I went through deprogramming. Then later on, I tried to sort of maintain our marriage because that was very important to me, but the church made that very difficult. And I am consequently now not married to the children's father, and he gets to take the children with him to the revival centre every second weekend.
So you actually, you are the resident parent, as it were?
Yes. Yeah.
Was that a court case, by the way?
No, we did manage to, the step before you actually get to court, we managed to sort that out in my favour before it went that far.
Well, that's very impressive. I must say, I would have presumed you may not have it been able to do so, given your past.
Yes, I really feel I was very fortunate. I had a lot of support there through my parents and my family and new friends that I managed to make, and that was a very, very hard thing. You know, you are completely ostracised when you leave, and nobody is allowed to have any contact with you.
Sorry to interrupt you, but like your parents, what sort of relationship had they maintained with you over these 18 years, in a sense?
They were just wonderful. They were always there for me, but I hate to say I wasn't there for them. The Revival Centre took over your life completely. You did everything. That was your first priority. But my parents, you know, were there for me, and when I finally did leave, they, were great. They really helped me with lots of things.
Did this deprogramming involve, by the way? You said you had 8 weeks of deprogramming.
Well, not the whole 8 weeks. The time I spent at the refuge, I had the opportunity to go and have deprogrammed through a mainstream church, and it was more sort of like counselling sessions where I could voice my fears. You know, I would tell them about the doctrine that I'd learned and had the opportunity to discuss it and hear other people's opinions and points of view and then decide what I thought about it.
So you're painting a picture, Sue, almost of a sort of callow person, you know, that you were not a developed personality by comparison, with other people whom you met in the outside world?
I would say that was so. We were allowed to socialise within the organisation and have other outside activities, but the whole focus was to meet people so that you could witness to them and bring them into the organisation. So socially, I was inept, and educational, I wanted to go back to work part-time when the children got a bit older, and I was, not able to do that.
What have been the real challenges, really, in setting up a new life, practically speaking?
Managing your finances. The church takes 10% of everything that you earn. You voluntarily give that, but it is very much part of their doctrine that that is necessary for salvation and for an ongoing walk with the Lord. So learning finances, being educated and learning to socialise, I think, are the main sort of things for me.
Learning to socialise.
Yes.
What do you mean?
Within the organisation, it's almost like you speak a separate language. You know, you have things like the baptismal tank and praise the Lord and, you know, those sorts of terms. When you leave, you are taught with that everybody else is evil. So all of a sudden you have to adapt your thinking and you have to realise that people are very nice. So instead of feeling afraid to meet people, you gain more confidence.
So that you felt almost naive by the sound of it, but around your peers?
Yes. At school I was quite a good socialiser, but I lost that through the Revival Centre. Even though I had friends within the Revival Centre, you had that common sort of ground. You all had the same gung-ho sort of thought of that. So you didn't discuss, you know, the news or current events. you had a one-tracked view on homosexuality. You know, it was whatever was taught to you. So now I've learnt there are many views, and they're different doesn't mean wrong.
You had a very good friend, or she sounds like a good friend, a librarian at a school you went and did voluntary work at, who really seems to me to have been quite a watershed for you.
Yes, that was my friend Anne, and she was just fantastic. I'm sure she won't mind me saying, but she's Catholic, and we were taught that they were very naughty people. And she was, when I left, I went to the local school and started doing volunteer work in the library, and this lady just took me under her wing and really was fantastic. You know, she encouraged me that I was a worthwhile and wonderful person.
Did you tell her about your history?
Gradually, yes, yes. And she was just fantastic. You know, she really accepted me as the person I was. She said I was great at library work and I should go and get, you know, some sort of qualifications, which I'm about to graduate with this at the end of this year.
What have you got?
I have a certificate in library studies.
Right.
So,
congratulations.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Incidentally, the children, how did they take this transition?
I think it's been very hard for them, and I think it will continue to be so until, you know, they're older. But my objective was to give them the opportunity to choose different lifestyles and different religions, if you like.
Mm.
And I feel that they have, or we've achieved that. Like, we do belong to a local fellowship group, a local church, and the children, sort of when they're with me, see one side of Christianity, and when they're with their father, they go to the cult. So I feel that they've at least had the opportunity to have the choice. They're wonderful children socially. You know, they mix really well at school. They're involved in lots of activities. We've lift off social security until I started working part-time, so it's been very hard financially, and they've missed out on some things through that.
Have they missed the sheer camaraderie of the cult?
Well, I think because they're still with their father every second weekend, they still have that, and I think that's why they're still happy to keep going. It's become more a social thing for them,
right,
rather than perhaps their spiritual beliefs, which I find more non-threatening than if they were sort of really gung-ho in there, accepting everything.
Now, Sue, you got married a week ago, I understand.
I did.
So what's gone into that decision? That's a big leap.
Well, from someone who came away from a relationship very disappointed, and who was sort of, the other woman was the church or the cult, I didn't ever think that would sort of happen, you know, that I would meet anybody that would, you know, I'd be able to share my life with. But that was through when I started part-time work. My boss at work encouraged me to join a social group through work, and I met this chap through there. And yeah, he's very understanding of our situation. My children, you know, just love him and have taken him on board, and we're looking forward to a very exciting life.
And you know, in terms of his friends, do you tell them all? You don't obviously see it as anything to be embarrassed about, what you've been through. It's your story and you tell it to people, do you?
Well, sometimes. Recently we went to a barbecue, and it did actually come up in conversation, and it really opened Pandora's box. You know, all of these people started discussing their sort of religious upbringing and different things that have influenced them, negative and positive. And it was a very interesting afternoon. And when we came away, I said, wow, you know, sort of never expected it to sort of be this sort of afternoon. But I don't tend to... No, I wouldn't say that, you know, I wear my heart on my sleeve as far as my past. I tend to like people to know me as the person I am at now rather than what I was then.
And do you feel happier now, even though life is more complex or more serene or what?
I would never change it, Geraldine. I just am so glad I had the courage and enough nerve to leave. Maybe I should have done it sooner. But, you know, we say that in hindsight, but the life I have now is just so much more fulfilling than the narrow one that I was leading before.
Even though it is more complex and no doubt and harder in its own way.
There's no black and white answers anymore.
All right. Well, look, the very best of luck. I hope you enjoy your new married life.
Well, it's been a week so far and it's fantastic.
Well, maybe.